Bladder cancer actually is quite, or cystoscopy is quite clear to see, because a normal bladder lining is very flat. But when you see a bladder cancer, typically it looks like a kind of seaweed.
Part 2 of our interview with Dr. Sachin Malde. You can watch part 1 on bladder installations on our channel. Now we're going to discuss bladder fulguration, bladder cancer, and other conditions. So let's jump into some of the questions we received about bladder fulguration and bladder cancer. The first question was, can cancer occur in any part of the urinary tract? And if so, is it most likely to occur in the bladder?
So cancer can occur in any part of the urinary tract. And by urinary tract, we're talking about kidneys, ureters, bladder, and urethra. Then in men, we also often include prostate as well. But if we're talking specifically just about urinary tract cancers, not including prostate, then actually in the UK, kidney cancer is probably the most common. And bladder cancer is second most common, but actually bladder cancer is a surprisingly very common condition. And it's the 11th most common cancer in the UK overall. And cancer in the ureters and urethra are relatively rare.
Okay. Do you know how the split of bladder cancer is across the population in male and female anatomy, certain ethnicities or certain age groups?
Yeah, absolutely. So the cancer is definitely much more common in men, bladder cancer. And we estimate that it's about 3 to 4 times more common in men than women.
Okay.
In terms of ethnicity, I think again, we do see it more commonly in Caucasian white populations, although it's thought that kind of mortality rates are higher in black populations, but again, that kind of varies by region. And so we don't know exactly. There are lots of factors influencing that. And it's definitely more common with age. So it's rare to see it under the age of 40.
Okay.
Possible, but rare. And it's much more common kind of over the age of 65, 70.
Okay. So what are the main risk factors, aside from what you just mentioned? Potentially medications or long-term infection or genetics a factor as well?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, developing cancer definitely depends on multiple factors. Genetic factors are definitely a key one of those, and environmental factors. So in terms of environmental factors, the commonest and by far the number one kind of big risk factor that we know of is smoking. So we know that smoking definitely increases the risk of bladder cancer. Probably around half of all bladder cancers are smoking related diseases. And the reason is that any toxic chemicals that make their way into the urine and then sit for long periods of time in contact with the bladder surface can then trigger genetic changes in the cells. They can irritate the bladder cells, causing genetic changes, which can then lead to cancer cells developing. And so smoking is kind of, you know, 4 times higher risk if you smoke of getting bladder cancer.
Right.
But other things, there are certain occupations that can also increase the risk, at least in the past. People that work with lots of chemicals or dyes were at slightly higher risk. Although nowadays, kind of the exposure tends to be within safety limits. Certain medications have been reported. So there's certain chemotherapy drugs has been reported as a possible risk factor. And we definitely know that if you have long-standing inflammation in the bladder, the bladder is very inflamed chronically, that can also lead to cancerous changes in cells.
So if the inflammation is due to long-term infection, there's an indirect link between long-term infection and bladder cancer potentially?
I think potentially. I think we don't know for sure with chronic UTI, for example, we don't know that, whether that's true or not, but certain bacteria or certain infectious diseases like schistosomiasis, for example, is a parasite disease. We definitely know there's a strong link between that and developing certain types of bladder cancer. We know in other parts of the body that chronic inflammation can ultimately lead to cancerous or precancerous changes developing in cells. And we know that in the bladder, for example, people that have long-term catheters in and get chronic inflammation of the bladder are also at slightly higher risk of getting bladder cancer. So I think, although we don't know for sure with chronic infection, I think it's something we need to consider.
Okay. What are the symptoms of possible bladder cancer, and are there early warning signs that might allow it to be caught and treated early?
So the patients with bladder cancer most commonly present with blood in the urine. That's the kind of commonest presenting symptom. So if someone's visibly seeing blood in the urine, or even non-visible blood that's just found on urine dipstick testing, it definitely warrants some kind of evaluation. Other symptoms include recurrent infections or pain on passing urine, or any new onset symptoms of frequency or urgency, especially older patients or patients who are smokers who have other risk factors, are kind of definite signs that we should be looking into something further. So I think anything with persistent blood on urine testing, visible blood, definitely needs to be considered.
A lot of people with UTI symptoms do experience blood in the urine and are never escalated to a potential bladder cancer diagnosis. What's the reason that they're not taken that seriously? Is it because bladder cancer is not that common and it's unlikely to be the cause?
So I think in the population of, so I think it really depends on the individual patients, because you're absolutely right in that the majority of patients who have recurrent or chronic infections, typically if they're kind of under the age of 40 or don't have any other common risk factors, actually the chance of finding anything abnormal like this is extremely rare. So it's not common at all. So I would typically recommend an ultrasound scan as a basic evaluation. But cystoscopy specifically in this specific group is unlikely to show much. But if someone is a lifelong smoker or has a history of bladder cancer, or is in the older age group or has visible blood, then definitely I think they should have at least at one point a cystoscopy just to know for sure that we haven't missed something.
Okay. You mentioned ultrasound and cystoscopy. Can you use those two methods to diagnose bladder cancer, or is one preferred over the other?
Well, as a kind of diagnostic test, the best by far, even better than ultrasound, CT or MRI, is a cystoscopy. So although it is invasive and a lot of patients don't like it, understandably, that definitely is the best way to diagnose bladder cancer, because small tumors, even on CT or MRI or ultrasound, won't necessarily get picked up. They're not that accurate. So if we're really concerned, then cystoscopy is definitely the best.
If you do a cystoscopy and you see something suspicious, so you take a biopsy, will you also remove the suspicious areas at the same time or wait for the results?
No, so the majority of patients, we remove it at the same time. Mm-hmm. So the treatment is under a short anaesthetic, it can, and the kind of abnormal areas fully removed and then sent to the lab for analysis. Okay. So it's kind of a treatment as well as a diagnostic thing all in one.
And then what kind of follow-up happens then? Do you do regular cystoscopies to make sure that it's being taken care of?
There is. So if it is kind of proven to be a bladder cancer, then it really depends on the type of bladder cancer as to what we then do next.
Okay.
Some people just need monitoring. It might be every 3 months. It might be every 6 months or yearly, depending on the type. Some patients need instillations into the bladder of certain chemicals to try and treat the cancer, depending on what type it is.
Okay. Are there any steps that someone can take to prevent bladder cancer? Quitting smoking sounds like the most important one if you are a smoker. Anything else?
No, absolutely. You're right. That's definitely the number one. 100% is stopping smoking. We know that actually if you stop smoking over kind of 5 to 10 years, your risk then goes back down to the risk of the normal population. So it's definitely something, it's kind of the key. The other thing is avoiding any kind of irritant chemicals. So, you know, if you're working with lots of chemicals and dyes, just trying to, you know, wear face masks, trying to avoid it, kind of inhaling those chemicals. And avoiding chronic inflammation in the bladder. So, you know, if people are at risk for that, or if people have chronic inflammation, then treating that potentially may reduce the risk of future cancer developing.
Okay. Can you explain what leukoplakia is and its connection with bladder cancer?
Yeah, absolutely. So leukoplakia it basically just means kind of white patch or white plaque, and you can see it in different parts of the body. So most commonly, actually, you find it in the mouth, just inside the cheek. And these white patches are basically there because of a layer of this chemical called keratin.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in the bladder, if we find leukoplakia, if we find white patches, typically that layer of keratin is on top of a kind of reddish area, which we call squamous metaplasia. In other words, slightly abnormal cells, mm-hmm. not cancerous cells, but just cells that have become inflamed. And so if we find these white patches, normally it's the result of long-standing irritation or inflammation in the bladder. And we definitely recommend removing that just to analyze in the lab, because in a very small number of patients, there can be precancerous cells mm-hmm. underneath the leukoplakia, which need either treatment or monitoring.
Okay. What does bladder cancer look like on cystoscopy?
So bladder cancer actually is quite, or cystoscopy is quite clear to see mm-hmm. generally, because the normal bladder lining is very flat and very smooth. But when you see a bladder cancer, typically it looks like a kind of seaweed. Mm-hmm. As a seaweed appearance, typically that kind of sticks out and is quite prominent. And so most patients, that's typically what we would see.
So we know that bladder fulguration is used for the removal of cancer in the bladder, but also sometimes for suspicious areas or infection. How deep do you have to go for those different scenarios in order to remove the area that needs to be removed?
So I think, like you say, it depends on why we're doing the resection. In bladder cancer, for example, we know that some bladder cancers can penetrate deeper into the bladder.
Mm.
So there are kind of three main layers in the bladder. There's a superficial most kind of lining, the urothelium top layer. Then we have a middle layer and then a deeper layer of muscle. And actually a cancer could be just superficial or it could go deeper into the muscle.
Mm-hmm.
And so the important thing with cancer treatment is when we're resecting those, we like to go deeper into the muscle to make sure we've got rid of all of it. At least to sample the muscle to know that the tumor is not going into the muscle. So I think that's important for bladder cancer. Whereas within inflammation, infection, or kind of ulcerated areas in the bladder, that's much more kind of superficial, the top one or two layer type process.
Mm-hmm.
And so we wouldn't typically go any deeper into the muscle in that situation, because otherwise it just increases the risk of complications.
Mm-hmm. Can bladder cancer, if it gets bad enough, lead to the necessary removal of the bladder itself?
It can do. So if we normally kind of classify bladder cancers as either non-muscle invasive, so in other words, it's just on those top mm-hmm. one or two layers, or muscle invasive. So as soon as it's got into the muscle, then actually the kind of best treatment is some kind of chemotherapy
mm-hmm.
followed by removing the whole bladder. Or mm-hmm. if people can't do that, then the radiotherapy treatment to the bladder is another option. But
okay.
normally removing the whole bladder is kind of the optimal option.
And once the bladder is removed, what are the options for that patient? Is it possible to reconstruct the bladder, or do they need to use an external bag of some kind?
So I would say that, again, depends a lot on the type of tumour and where exactly the tumour is in the bladder. Mm-hmm. For the majority of patients, especially in the UK, for the majority of patients, we make what we call a stoma bag or a urostomy bag, mm-hmm. which comes out on the tummy, on the skin, and the urine just constantly drains into that bag. That's the kind of most straightforward way of diverting the urine when the bladder's gone. Mm-hmm. But for some patients, you can make a new bladder out of their own small intestine, a small bowel, but that's much more of a complex procedure, so it's only really suitable for specific types of tumor specific patients.
Okay. And you mentioned also that you do fulguration for chronic infection or inflammation in your practice. In what cases would you recommend that for a patient rather than antibiotic treatment?
So I think my number one treatment is antibiotic based. Mm-hmm. And lots of non-antibiotic measures, like, for example, methenamine hippurate. But the fulguration I would typically recommend if patients have leukoplakia, like we were saying before, white plaques, or lots of kind of very inflamed, bleeding or ulcerated areas in the bladder, then we do get good results, especially in terms of pain relief with fulguration, with diathermy machine or laser to that area.